Greetings, fellow primates. We humans are the planet-altering ape, a title we richly deserve due to the global impact of our collective activity. The late Charles Keeling of UC San Diego's Scripps Institute of Oceanography was the first to start measuring the human-caused increase in atmospheric carbon dioxide. Last measures from just this a week ago show that they have risen to 420 parts per million. When he first measured them in 58, they were 315 parts per million. Measurements around the world by several agencies are confirming that global average temperatures are rising, and humans on every continent are experiencing increased events of extreme weather. So we are the planet-altering ape. We humans are driving climate change and ocean acidification. Extinction is part of the evolutionary process. Current rates of extinction are rather high, and fossil scientific data allow us to compare current extinction rates with those in the planet's distant past. The verdict is in. Current extinction rates are as high as the five major extinction events in the history of our planet. We are the planet-altering ape. We humans are causing the sixth mass extinction and potentially hastening our own extinction. An extraterrestrial view of the planet reveals a striking contrast in the distribution of us humans and our closest living relatives, the great apes. Our ape cousins, two of them more closely related to us than they are to the other apes, are restricted to the tropical forests of Africa and Asia, while humans are found all over the planet. All great apes are currently endangered due to human activity, while we are over 8 billion people. Humans stand out by having dual inheritance. Like all other life forms, we have genetics based on the transmission of molecules from generation to generation. Uniquely, we have culture, which is based on the transmission of ideas and norms. Our cumulative culture, made possible by this unique combination of abilities, cooperation, language, imagination, self-awareness, and behavioral flexibility, has allowed us to go all over the planet, inhabit every possible habitat, and develop powerful technology. Technology that includes photographs from space of the planet, allowing humans to monitor the state of the world in real time. How did we become the planet-altering ape? To answer that, let's take a quick look at our evolutionary history. 3 million years ago, fossils in Africa provide strong evidence that our distant ancestors were bipedal over 6 million years ago. That means these were small apes that spent a lot of time in the trees still. By 3 million years, we find fossils, again, only in Africa, of bipedal apes, hominins, that were called australopithecines, southern apes, with more modern feet and more modern hands, allowing them to roam further and start making tools and using simple tools. Their brains, however, were roughly the size of a living ape. They gave rise to another lineage, nicknamed Nutcracker Man, the robust australopithecines, still with small brains, huge masticatory apparatus, jaws and teeth. That was the vegetarian experiment. They did very well, but went extinct over 1 million years ago. Another lineage arising from the Australopithecines was the Homo lineage. Homo erectus, 2 million years ago, was a tall, striding bipedalist that could run sustainably, a top scavenger or predator, an omnivore, capable of making complex tools, and with a brain that started increasing in size, up to 3 times the volume of an ape in present-day humans. Importantly, all the oldest, any fossil older than 2 million years old is found only in Africa. And we know from genetics, from humans all over the world, that all of us share an ancestry in Africa. By 1.6 million years, Homo erectus made it all the way to East Asia. Outside Africa, Homo erectus gave rise to several species of now extinct archaic hominins, including Neanderthals and Denisovans in Eurasia, and at least two species of small extinct hominids, Homo luzonensis and Homo floresiensis. The average lifetime of a hominin species was over 1 million years. We, Homo sapiens, have only been around for a third of that time. And it's amazing to think that as recently as 50,000 years ago, there were 5 different species of humans roaming the planet. Us, our ancestors, and 4 others. They've all gone extinct since. There is a debate raging about the role of Homo sapiens in the demise of these 4 extinct species. Conflict and competition are a distinct possibility, but we might simply have loved them into oblivion with large numbers of our ancestors interbreeding with much smaller populations of these archaic hominids. So while the jury is out about our role of doing in these other humans, we know that the jury is not out. We have an established role in displacing other species. Ecological studies reveal that Africa still has a lot of large land vertebrates, big mammals, heavier than 100 pounds. But every other continent seems to be lacking a large number of large animals. Where did they go? We drove them to extinction. Wherever Homo sapiens arrived, there were mass die-offs of large animals, proving that we gained the capacity as the planet-altering ape to drive extinctions on all continents but Africa. In Africa, you see here the animals in green that survive and in black that went extinct. In Africa, most of them are still alive. They co-evolved with humans, so they proved that coexistence is possible. But outside Africa, our rise to ecological dominance had a very steep ecological cost. So we would hope that we can use our distinct combination of abilities, cooperation, language, imagination, self-awareness, and behavioral flexibility to foster coexistence, preventing extinctions and even our own demise. After the last ice age, a little bit under 12,000 years ago, humans around the world invented farming multiple times, at least 11 different times independently. The idea of farming is you domesticate plants, you domesticate animals, and you produce surplus food. That surplus food drives population expansions. Larger populations give you more complex societies and eventually civilizations with all their norms and institutions and technologies. All civilizations we know of were driven by the consumption of starch from grains and tubers. And most of us have learned in school about this march of progress towards civilization. Don't forget that these developments came at a huge cost to the vast majority of individuals slaving away, laboring away on their fields. Farming brought us the 5 P's: poverty, poor health, plunder, politics, and power differentials. A very high cost indeed. But farming, the civilization, also developed an accumulation of knowledge and new belief systems and values, many of them centered around the idea of compassion and respect for others, enlarging the circle that included in that respect. One of the key ideas, known as the golden rule, here the positive version, is treat others the way you would have them treat you. It's so simple, yet we all struggle with it like crazy. Why is that? Why can't we just follow this? We'd be much better off. As a primatologist, I'd like to convince you that it has to do with something we share with other primates. There is a key Swahili proverb, Nyani haoni kondule, huliona la mwenziwe. The baboon only sees the backside of the other baboon. Just like we only notice when somebody else breaks the golden rule and we're blissfully oblivious when we break it. Animal domestication was a mixed blessing. Domesticated animals provided protection, food, materials, and transportation. But they also introduced another 3 P's: pathogens, parasites, and pestilence. Dogs were the first animal to be domesticated, possibly as early as 30,000 years ago. For all of our existence of our ancestors, they lived in constant fear of predation by large predators, lions, hyenas, bears, and wolves. Domesticated dogs were an incredible protection from that, and of course, our beloved companions. Cats were critical because the minute you start accumulating grains, when you have farming, you need cats to control the rodents. And cats to this day cherish being served by the human staff. And of course, humans moved cats to places like Australia and New Zealand, where they wreak ecological disasters as well. That's the one thing we do very well as humans. So we humans, as the planet-altering ape, have modified the planet through farming, mining, construction. And this has had a lot of downsides, a lot of upsides, like these civilizations with their good aspects. And it has created a kind of ecological emancipation. It has freed us from constant fear and having to look for food and shelter every day. With ecological emancipation come widening values, knowledge and awareness of our own evolution, new tools to probe the planet, and to gauge the adverse effects of humans, to project the consequences of our actions, to reflect, and to plan for what we want rather than what we inherit. With ecological emancipation, you also can start appreciating nature for values beyond utilitarianism. You can take in landscapes, you can enjoy ecosystems with even the large, very dangerous animals, or the small dangerous animals like this red-bellied newt from Sonoma that packs enough tetrodotoxin to be lethal to an adult, so you don't lick them and you don't eat them. And more recently, we've actually begun to really appreciate the microbial communities that live in and around our bodies and provide really important services. So our impact on the planet should convince us to use that unique combination of abilities that we as humans have: cooperation, language, imagination, self-awareness, and flexibility to delay extinctions rather than accelerate them. Humanity today feeds itself by grains from four different plants, three grasses and one legume: corn, rice, wheat, and soybeans. To feed humanity in the future, we will need novel approaches to farming that diversify crops and learn from what we've learned from natural ecosystems. Things like the production of highly prized meat for the global meat market are simply utterly unsustainable. And if we are to feed 10 billion people sustainably, there will be no other option than to rely mostly on plant-based food. Even in Africa, where these large wild populations of animals remain, they're now all outnumbered by cattle. In Tanzania alone, where there are about 5 million large megavertebrate wild animals, there are 33 million heads of cattle, 6 cows for every wild animal. But there have been moves in the right direction there. International agreements such as the ivory ban 30 years ago have actually led to a doubling of the populations of elephants and white rhino and black rhino in Kenya. They prove that we can reverse the extinction trends, and we need many more of these attempts. Because our ever-growing need for natural resources, gas, oil, minerals, timber, and pasture, is causing us to encroach into ecosystems more and more, even ecosystems with very few people or with people living in extreme poverty. And when we do so, we know what happens. We get zoonoses, emerging diseases, such as the epidemics and pandemics of Ebola, SARS, MERS, monkeypox, and COVID, of course. But there too, international collaboration and communication have proven that we can track novel viruses in real time by the RNA sequence, detect new emerging variants, and develop vaccines that save millions of lives. Our footprint, our ecological footprint, is determined by the number of people and how many resources we each use. Most of us living in the Northern Hemisphere, and those of us living in richer countries in the Global South, have a disproportionate impact and a huge global footprint because we consume so much energy and buy so much stuff that we have sent to our homes with Amazon. And most of it ends up there, in the landfill here in San Diego and everywhere else, and even in the middle of the Pacific Ocean trash vortex. But there is some good news too. And another example, a third example of international cooperation is the United Nations Basel Convention, which now strictly regulates the movement of dangerous waste from rich countries to poor countries. And we'll need many more arrangements like that to level the playing field. So while extinction is a natural part of the evolutionary process, the current high rate of extinction directly caused by all our behavior demands that we change our ways. We would hope that our evolved pro-social tendencies allow us to find a way to create a stable future. Efforts such as community-based conservation are based on the realization that coexistence between humans and healthy ecosystems has huge mutual benefit. But they don't suffice. For such coexistence, we also need a massive adjustment of the disproportionate use of resources by rich countries over poorer countries. Remember that simple rule? So we need to rely on our evolved pro-social tendencies, our sense of fairness, and our newly emerging planetary consciousness to find solutions. And this very famous iconic picture called Earthrise, taken in 1968 by a human on the moon, a huge collaborative effort, an international effort, is a reminder of that. I have given you three examples of international agreements that are far from perfect, but they prove that we humans have a track record in global communication and cooperation. As my friend, the Kenyan conservationist David Jonah Weston says, we alone have the awareness, will, and if not yet, the means to conserve future biodiversity. But doing so will require a massive adjustment in attitude and action at multiple levels: personal, private, public, political, and planetary. And I would argue that a deep appreciation of our shared humanity and international cooperation and communication are the only hope we have. We can decide to become the planet-protecting ape. Thank you.